the re-embrace of religion makes a tremendous amount of sense. We are so far off track, and it's so obvious. And atheism has something to do with that. I don't think atheism is the cause, but it took the safety off the gun. And civilization has now run away into this hyper-novelty spiral that is, it's literally destroying us. You can see the individuals are not well. The civilization is not well. This is going to end badly. It is absolutely natural, and I would imagine that if we had the ability to look back into history with sufficient resolution, we would see that there is a retreat into orthodoxy at the point that you find that your civilization has gone nuts. And I think even in what little I understand of the sacred texts, this is discussed, right? That, you know, Sodom and Gomorrah are something, and the idea is there's something to retreat to when a civilization has lost its mind. So it's not surprising that we would see this re-embrace of these ancient traditions. Here's the part that's going to be a stretch. We can't do it, and we must do it, right? We have to get out of this spiral. We absolutely have to. It may well be that the best tools we have are ancient wisdom patterns that our ancestors knew, but we can't return to them because we don't live in their world. And that's the problem. So really, I think the question is, can we embrace the need to retreat from our hurtling into chaos? And can the religions figure out how to, I wish I had a better word than modernize, but can the religions bring themselves up to date for a world that their authors didn't know anything about either? And that is not an easy trick to do, because when you look back at an ancient religious text, which we regard as the product of evolution, right? It is a compendium of wisdom that was built by an evolutionary force that pruned the wheat from the chaff. It is not up to date to modern circumstances. That said, there's nobody on earth who can look at those texts and say, here's the part that's still relevant as written. Here's the part that's relevant, but it's written in such a way that you'll derive the wrong lesson from it. And here's the part that has become toxic because the new circumstances are radically different from the old ones. There's nobody on earth who can do that job. It's, you know, it's Chesterton's fence all the way down. And so when you're faced with that puzzle, we have to agree on some fundamentals. We have to agree on what the objective of the exercise is, right? I would argue the most fundamental objective, we don't go extinct. Second most fundamental, we liberate people meaningfully as much as possible. Beyond that, there are a lot of questions about what structures are net positive, what structures are net negative, and there's no ancient tradition that's up to the challenge as written. If we can all see that, if we can understand that you can't go back, you can go some degree back, some places yes, some places no, we are going to go forward one way or the other. And we have a lot of control over whether we go forward into hell or we go forward through the adaptive valley into some better future that we can't really envision from here. If we understand that that's the puzzle and we are careful about our embrace of tradition, recognizing that it's a natural moment for that to be arising, then there's a lot of hope. But if we're going to embrace the orthodoxy without recognizing that it's not a good fit for the 21st century, if we're going to abandon it and hurtle headlong, I don't see much of a future for humanity. I think both of those are fatal errors.
Well, I actually have a question for you, in part because we have a number of friends who do not have faith, as we do not. And these number of friends increasingly say things like, I wish I believed. I wish I had a religion. And I don't quite know what that means, but I've heard it from a number of people at this point. And I think that we live in a way as if there is a moral good, even though we do not believe in an external force that is imposing it. And I wonder, you said that you feel like you're becoming more Catholic every day. What does that mean to you? Like, how does that manifest? Or how are your beliefs or your actions, or is it one or the other, that are becoming more Catholic? I'm trying to wrestle with what people mean at this point when they say, I am religious, or I wish that I had faith.
So, I offhandedly will say I'm like the closest thing Christians can be to Jewish, which is I'm 100% Italian and raised Catholic and went to being Catholic is woven into my genetic lineage in a certain sense. It's like the Pope is in Rome. We're actually sending our son to Italy for college, and to Rome. It'll be a short trip to the Vatican. So. To answer your question, it's a couple of things. So first, very tangibly, we made a bunch of education choices for our son that were very active about all the things that you write about in your book. We put him in a Waldorf school when he was little and did no media until he was, pretty old, relatively speaking. And then we've moved him around multiple times. But one of the things that didn't happen is he didn't get confirmed. He got baptized when he was born, but he didn't go through any of the other religious parts of the Catholic sacraments. Catholicism's got a lot of doodads and a lot of rituals. And so I'm actually every Sunday going with him for several hours to this adult rite for him to get confirmed. It'll actually happen in April after Easter. So that's a tangible thing I'm doing. And what I'm finding is... it's pretty amazing. It's amazing to be there with him even when it's boring, which often it is, every time it sparks an existential conversation between us as we drive away. The way I think about it increasingly is on multiple levels. Because I'm like a cerebral guy. But there's a couple things that are part of what attracts me back to this thing I inherited just by accident of birth and family. One is that I like that it hasn't changed very much. As I mentioned, like the lighthouse at night. Like, you don't know where humanity invented lighthouses because when you're in a ship and it's dark and you're in the water, you need something that's on solid ground so you know how far you are from there, even if you don't intend to land and dock. It's like, okay, that's where that is. I know that's always there. And that anchor I find powerful. I think the other piece of the puzzle for me is there is a logic that I think is in the old, it's in what God says to Moses in the Bible. Moses asks him, who are you? What should I call you? And he says, I am who I am, or I am being. I am being. And that even, I don't know if scientifically is the right word. It almost certainly is not. But the notion that there is a sort of, there is a thing that is being, that is not nothing, but it is the meta of being, strikes me as being profoundly true. In the same way that the number two is almost an adjective. Or two books, one, two. But there is a number two that is an abstract thing that is both real and also not real. And what does that mean that it's that there's this thing number two, and we can use, or any number for that matter, and we can use math, and it's like, and that it works. Like, it's completely crazy that math works. Like, math shouldn't work. What's that mean? I'm like way off the reservation, and Brett, your brother, would probably have all kinds of stuff to say about this as a mathematician. But I look at all that and I say, you know what? I'm doubling down, man. I'm doubling down. I can see where we are. And you know what? God, thank God that going to mass actually feels nostalgic. So I actually like it. And it's a meditation. And you know what? I don't see any conflict between science and faith at all. These are two different lenses on two different planes. You know, I went to 12 years of Catholic school. Evolution was taught. There was nothing unscientific about it. And then the other piece of the puzzle too is I think one of the things that impacted me so much about 10-7 and so much about is I have a deep connection to Judaism by way of my Catholicism and my relationships and my friendships. And I see this unbroken brotherhood that is, I think, the bedrock of why we're here still. And I want to be a part of that. And why not be a part of it? I think I'm only here once. So I'm going to just go with the thing that seems like it, you know, makes sense. And, you know, if I'm going to be Christian, why not be the OG? Like, none of those are, you asked, so I'm taking the liberty here to lay it out. But is that persuasive to people? I don't know. I watched this video about, you've mentioned fractals several times. And there's this great video, and it's got a provocative YouTube clickbait title, like the math that no atheist wants you to see. And it's just the Mandelbrot set. And it's a mathematician who is also a Christian zooming into the Mandelbrot set. And so the Mandelbrot set, for people who don't know it, you should Google it, is basically like this visualization of a very simple equation that plots dots on a graph. And when you run it through a computer, it gives you infinite emergent complexity that is also beautiful, none of which makes any damn sense. It doesn't make sense why a simple equation would give rise to infinite complexity that doesn't repeat. You zoom in and it looks the same, but it's slightly different. You zoom in on this little tendril and it looks really different. And, oh, what's this part over here that looks like an ocean? And, oh, these spirals look like about 1,000 other things I see in nature. And so that's like all in my head. And then there's this other piece of the moral puzzle, and I'll stop talking because as an interviewer, this is like, I shouldn't be doing this much, but you asked. And I think this might be a good place to end our conversation. And I'll just give you my take and then I'll ask you for yours. I don't see an argument that sticks for the equal dignity of every human being absent creation and a soul. Because we're not all equal. Some are smart, some are dumb, some are ugly, some are weak, some are tall, some are short, some are malevolent, some are altruistic. But like, one thing we're not is equal. Like, we're not equal. Equality is an abstraction and an invention. It's not a product of reality. And yet I think equality of dignity, equality of our humanness, that means I shouldn't kill you in the service of something, because that's just plain wrong because of our equal dignity. I have tried to find a suitable non-religious justification for that, and I don't see it. And utilitarianism doesn't stack up because you can't measure utility. So it's like, we've got an equation for what is good. How do you measure it? Well, we can't. So, okay, well, great. But that sounds like nonsense. So that's my long-winded answer to your question. I mean, you can react however you see fit to my diatribe. But my last question would be, as in this whole conversation, as biologists, as people that study evolution, how do you understand the justification for the equal dignity of every human being?
I don't know how to answer that last question. I would love to have the opportunity to spend a long time talking about what you just said, and we don't have that time. I have two, I think, relatively trivial linguistic responses that would point to some deeper conversation, perhaps in a future conversation. The rituals that you're going, the Catholic rituals that you're exploring with your son on a weekly basis now, point to, you know, must be the shared etymology of rites of passage and ritual. And this is absolutely one of the benefits of religion. And when humans have tried to create that kind of community with enforcement of rites and rituals in the same way absent religion, they normally fail. And so there is utility, whether or not the utility emerges from something that is actually manifestly real in the universe. There's utility in having the authority implied that says, actually, it's time to do this. You must do this. And then with regard to the Mandelbrot set and the variation and the truth and the beauty that emerge, the words that come to mind are Darwin's in the end of On the Origin of Species, in which he talks about endless forms most beautiful. So there's convergence of truth and beauty and reality in these different approaches to understanding the world.
Well, interestingly, I'm not even sure it's an analogy, because Mandelbrot was motivated to innovate fractal math because of its inadequacy for fundamentally biological questions. And so anyway, it's there very directly. With respect to your question, I think I don't really want to answer it well, because I like the idea of this fundamental dignity that doesn't require an explanation, but I think there is one, and it's more or less an analogy for when we say that a colorblind society is desirable, right? We don't mean actually unable to see color, but we mean that it's not supposed to matter with respect to your rights and obligations. And this is the same, you know, a psychopath doesn't have equal dignity as far as I'm concerned. They have lost it, but they were entitled to it before they became what they were. I do want to wrap up, though, by pointing out that in our book, we describe that human beings, in order to get from one niche to the other, have a dual mode, that we go from a cultural mode when our ancestors knew well what how to exploit a habitat and how to be, into a conscious mode when we're in an environment we don't understand. And so my point about we have to embrace some of what we've been while being open to innovating something that we haven't yet been is an invitation. And the tool that we describe involves a distinction between the sacred, things that are so fundamental that you dare not mess with them at all, and what we call the shamanistic. And the shamanistic is the experimental side of something that is tied to the same structure. So the way religions modernize themselves is that they have this shamanistic side that innovates and discovers what has to be added to the religion to update it for the new realities. You could make the argument that Christianity itself is a shamanistic update to Judaism. So where are we? I think we are in the moment where we cannot embrace the orthodoxy so absolutely that we abandon the obligation to figure out how to modernize these traditions. We need the shamanistic element. It is that moment, and if we don't do that part, we may save ourselves in the short term, but do ourselves in the long term.
I have a question you can answer quickly. I end every conversation with this, and this has been... I've been such a fan of both of you and your contributions to my own thinking that it's been a real honor and a privilege to have this conversation. We call this Dad Saves America because I believe, as men in particular, it is a role that the saving of America requires, that we can't get there from here if we as men don't embrace the heroic nature of being. The heroic role of being a father, but the heroic role also of just being an adult and transmitting that to our kids. How do you, each of you, think about your role in the American story? Go ahead. I'll direct it at you first.
Okay. I think it was addressed in many places in this conversation, right? We have an obligation to get our civilization through the bottleneck that we very obviously face. We have this obligation for a long-term lineage level purpose that's hard for us to actually see. and we can see it manifest in flesh and blood in our own children. And that's good enough. To the extent that we understand that our kids are in danger and that we have to fix the structure that they are depending on in order for there to be a future at all, that's the job. And anybody who doesn't see it needs to look harder.
Heather, how about you?
I think that's right. Traveling far afield in my 20s, sometimes with Bret, sometimes independently, made me an adult, honestly, and also made me a patriot. And it's not that I thought America was evil. I wasn't one of those people before that, but I didn't understand what all it brought to the table. And seeing some of the alternatives out there brought reality home. And I think that may be one of the themes of what we have been doing when we are professors and now that we are communicating with the world differently. You know, get out of your own self long enough to recognize the outstanding value of what it is that we have in the United States and what it is that we are risking with what we are doing.
If you like this clip, you should check out the full video and all the other great content we've got at Dad Saves America. So be sure to hit the like button, subscribe, and ring that bell so you won't miss our new stuff as it drops each week.